A warm good evening to one and all. On behalf of our management, Bapatla Educational Society, Principal Sir, staff and students of Bapatla College of Pharmacy, I cordially welcome you all to the third day of our three-day International Online Short-Term Training Program on Analytical Research Trends in Pharmaceutical Industry, organized by Department of Pharmaceutical Analysis, in association with Indian Pharmaceutical Association Education Division. Today's topic is Elemental Impurities in Pharmaceuticals, an overview of analytical techniques. It is a great privilege to introduce our guest of honor and speaker, Dr. Ravi Jaipal. Dr. Ravi Jaipal is a living idiom of a person who happened to born at the right time and at the right place. Coupled with impressive background, it was not therefore surprising that he became a co-founder, president, and chief executive officer at Citragen Pharmaceuticals. Dr. Ravi Jaipal holds his MPharmacy from JSS College of Pharmacy in 2000. He did his BPharmacy from JSS College of Pharmacy, UT, in 1998. Our speaker is having over 20 years of research, commercial manufacturing and management experience in various roles within pharmaceutical industry. He is having experience and knowledge with regulatory requirements of US FDA and other international regulatory agencies. Having been a part of over 100 drug product regulatory filings, approvals with US FDA, he is owing strong knowledge and hands-on experience with analytical techniques and instrumentations involved in pharmaceutical research, regulatory, quality control, and manufacturing. Coming to administration of our speaker, Dr. Ravi Jaipal, he is experienced in management and administration of quality system and manufacturing teams. He established and operated multi-site manufacturing setups, also served as member in strategic team to select product and marketing plans. Coming to his research background, he is having fast-track product development history. He filed about 90 ANDAs and US FDA in 4 years. He created internal system and managed small to large research groups, managed and delivered complex drug product development projects. Moving on to his regulatory background, Dr. Ravi Jaipal have hands-on experience with FDA and other major international regulatory agencies, filed and handled wide range of products, managed distributors, regulatory needs, and served as technical lead for them. Coming to his business, he played key role in business transformations of a OTC drug company into an ANDA development company and a non-regulated API business into an regulated formulations business with international operation. Coming to his experience, he primarily worked in Aurobindo Pharma Limited as an head for formulation analytical research development for 3 years. Then he moved on to Concord Labs and worked there as a manager for analytical R&D for a period of 4 years. Then he moved to Formorex. He worked there as a director for analytical research for a period of 5 years. Presently, our speaker, he is working in Citragen Pharmaceuticals as a president and CEO from 2017. Sir, we are very pleased to have you as a speaker today, sir. Ravi Jaipal, sir, you can start your presentation by sharing your screen.
Thank you, Sushma.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, everyone. So today I'm going to discuss about the elemental impurities in pharmaceuticals. So this is, I'm going to give an overview of the analytical techniques and the regulatory requirements. So this, I splitted the whole presentation in three major areas. So one is the first, I will give an background about the elemental impurities in the pharmaceuticals. Then I will go over about the global regulatory requirements with respect to the elemental impurities for the pharmaceutical products. And then I will give a brief overview on the analytical techniques, whereby we can use different techniques to analyze these elemental impurities. Moving on to the elemental impurities, what are elemental impurities? That is the first question when we talk about the elemental impurities. So the elemental impurities are the trace metals that can be found in active pharmaceutical ingredients, excipients, or finished products. Commonly, they are known as or classified as inorganic impurities. So where these inorganic impurities or metal impurities in pharmaceutical can originate. So these can originate from different sources. For example, the raw materials which we use for the products, either it can be synthetic or plant or animal sources or the proteins or microbiological products, all these raw materials and excipients. So different categories of excipients we use in our drug products like stabilizers, coating materials, binders, release agents, flavors, and colors. So all these excipients, all we call it as excipients. And then the contaminants which are introduced during the manufacturing process of active pharmaceutical ingredients and drug products. For example, they can leach from the pipes of which we transfer the product, either liquid or API slurry from one vessel to other vessel. Also the vessels, the gaskets, and other processing equipments. And then there are many cases we deliberately add the metals as catalysts to speed up the reactions in the synthesis process. Also, we have leachable impurities which can come from the packaging materials, like from the container closures. So why controlling or monitoring these impurities in pharmaceutical products are very important? Because most of the elemental impurities, such as arsenic, cadmium, lead, are having a highly toxicological risk to patients without providing any therapeutic benefit. So the chronic consumption of these contaminated drugs may result in multiple unwanted health risks to patients, since the elemental impurities can be unknowingly consumed additionally through contaminated food, water, etc. Because every day we take foods like ready-made foods, junk foods, and all those things. So these all can additionally add these elemental impurities to our body. So how these impurities are monitored and what are the methods commonly employed? Commonly, traditionally, these impurities were controlled by non-specific limit test methods, popularly known as limit test for heavy metals, sulfated ash, limit test for arsenic, residue on ignition, etc., etc. There are so many tests we do for our raw materials, excipients. So many of these tests are indirectly reporting these metal impurities. So these limit test procedures are about 100 years old procedures, and they are known to have many issues. Because most of these limit tests are based on the visual endpoints, such as color comparison, turbidity comparison, et cetera, based on the capability of the inorganic substances to form colored complex with other reagents. So these usually became very subjective and cause accuracy issues. For example, the red color, which is dark to me, is not dark to you or somebody else. So always it is subjective matter. So what happened is during 1995, USP published a Stumile article in Pharmacopeial Forum. So that is describing with several problems like this, specifically with the sulfide precipitation method, which is commonly used in the heavy metal testing, which resulted in very poor recovery and very variable results between the labs, between the analysts, and it was lack of selectivity, everything they discovered during that process. So this led to the discussion of creating a harmonized standard for this test on a global scale. Following USP initiation in 1998, European Medicines Agency, EMA, they began to develop the guideline on residual catalysts for in pharmaceuticals. Their main goal was to establish limits based on the toxicological safety assessment elements. Because before that, all the limit tests, we used to have arbitrary limit of 10 ppm, 20 ppm based on the dose. So there was no basis for those limits. So first, European Medicine Agency started the work to establish these limits based on the toxicological safety of these commonly used metals. Then this process took a long time, and in 2008, the EMA guideline on specification limits for the residue of metal catalysts or metal reagents was officially implemented for new drug products. So this EMA guideline introduced a mass-based permitted daily exposure levels. In short form, they call it as PDEs. So these are based on the assessment of toxicological data on individual metals to establish permissible exposure in drug products, rather than the concentration in the drug substance or in the excipients. So during this time, in parallel between 2000 to 2008, USP initiated a series of workshops and stakeholder forums for the purpose of revising these heavy metal limits. That is a USP general chapter, which is commonly known as USP 231. So that is the one which governed the USP's heavy metal testing procedures. So during this time, what happened is several papers from the industry and academia and other voluntary organizations like equipment manufacturers all evaluated the suitability of modern instrumental methods of analysis for elemental impurity analysis for the pharmaceutical products and the drug products. Because the elemental impurities are already extensively analyzed in the environmental analysis as well as in the food industries. So later in 2008, the USP proposed a chapter to replace the 231 with two chapters. So the USP 232 and USP 233. So in this USP 232 will establish safety-based limits on the elemental impurities for pharmaceutical products. And they proposed the 233 would establish appropriate criteria for the methods for the elemental analysis. So with this background, in 2009, ICH committee, the International Council for Harmonization, they established an expert working group involving many people from different pharmacopoeias and industry experts and equipment manufacturers. All these people together, they formed a working group to work on elemental impurities in pharmaceutical products. Their main intention is to harmonize the technical requirements for the elemental impurities in pharmaceutical products across three regions, Europe, Japan, and US, because these three regions were the major markets at that point of time. So they started with the goal of harmonizing these three regions. As with EMA guideline and the USP chapters, the ICH expert committee, Q3D expert working group, endeavor to set maximum PDEs for elemental impurities in pharmaceutical products based on the toxicological data for the oral, parenteral, and inhalation routes of administration, since these three are the most common used routes of administration in the pharmaceutical industry. So in June 2013, ICH published a first draft version of the ICH guideline, which is ICH Q3D guideline, for the public review and comments. During 2014 to 2018, major international pharmacopoeias, such as like United States Pharmacopoeia, USP, European Pharmacopoeia, Japanese Pharmacopoeia, British Pharmacopoeia, and other major international regulatory agencies like FDA, EMA, MHRA, UK MHRA, Australia's TGA, and Japan's PMDA all discussed with ICH and harmonized with ICH as their requirements for the approval of new drug products. In January 2018, USP officially enacted the revised chapters of 232 and 233 and depreciated the old chapter 231, effective from January 2019. So basically, they gave industry 1 year time to adapt to the new guidelines. So the latest ICH Q3D guideline, which is now available, is the R1 version, which is a revision 1 version. So that was recently issued on March 2019. So now when we talk about the elemental impurity, it is practically impossible to monitor a drug product for every element in the table of elements. So therefore, what they did is the elements to be monitored are selected and they included in the guideline based on the toxicity, that is the permitted daily exposure, and their likelihood occurrence in a drug product, whether it can come into a drug product. If it comes into a drug product, how much that toxicity is going to affect a patient or a human being. So these toxicity limits, they derived from a process called no observed effect level or the lowest observed effect level. They are all mostly derived based on the animal studies. They did various animal studies like rodent, non-rodent, and all these using mice, rabbit, rat, and everything. So based on this PDEs, a total of 24 elements has been identified as elemental impurities and are specified with their toxicity limits, defined as maximum permitted daily exposure levels in microgram per day for the four major drug delivery categories. And they are classified into three major categories. So the categories of the elements are the elemental impurity classes are, so they classified as class one, which is these elements are known to be human toxicants. They have very limited or no use in the manufacture of pharmaceuticals. Their presence in the drug products typically comes from commonly used materials or the excipients, mostly from the mined excipients. So the four elements which are belongs to class one are arsenic, cadmium, mercury, and lead. So these are pretty much known as very toxic to us. So they put this as a highly toxic category in class one. So then they came to the class two, where they classified the route dependent elements which are toxic to human. And they further divided this into two classes as class 2A and class 2B based on their relative likelihood occurrence in the drug product. So whether they can easily come or how it can come. So most of these elements are either it can be used as a catalyst or it can be come from the process equipments like that. So they put cobalt, nickel, and vanadium as class 2A because these elements have high, relatively high probability of occurrence in a drug product, because nickel can come from a stainless steel leaching, vanadium can come from a stainless steel alloy, as well as cobalt can come from aluminum alloy. So these all are quite possible to come into a drug products. So these impurities also have a risk assessment process for depending on the route of administration, how the drug product is administered. So then the class 2B, these elements have reduced probability of occurrence. That means they are not commonly coming from a process perspective unless we add it as a catalyst or some other purpose. So these are considered as low abundance and low potential, and it has to be co-isolated with other materials. So as a result, they may be excluded from the risk assessment unless we add it as intentionally during the manufacturing of drug substance or excipient or other components of a drug product. So then the third category, class three, is very low toxicity elements when they are administered through a oral route. Usually they are more than 500 microgram per day is safer for permitted exposure levels. But these are not same level of risk when it comes to the parenteral inhalation products. So for oral administration, unless these elements are intentionally added, they don't need to be monitored. But parenteral and inhalation products, the potential for inclusion of these elemental impurities should be evaluated during the risk assessment. Unless the route is specifically more than 500 microgram per day. So these are the 24 impurities and their limits and how we do the risk assessment. So out of these 24 elements, any element, if we add it in the drug product route, in any of the route of administration, either in the drug substance synthesis or the API synthesis or the excipient or in the container closure system. So any of this, then we have to evaluate this for the risk assessment. In addition, whether or not we intentionally add, the class 1 and class 2A element must be evaluated for the risk assessment because they are highly toxic. Then specific class 2B and class 2-3 elements, as mentioned in the table, we have to do the risk assessment depending on the route. For example, if we do the parenteral drug product, lithium and then tin, the antimony and the copper are to be evaluated. In addition to the class 1 and class 2A, for example, so here they mentioned we have to monitor the lithium and antimony and the copper when we do the parenteral. Same way, for inhalation, they have given the high risk categories because these all are less than 500 microgram per day when it comes to that specific route. So the toxicity risk is higher in that route. So when we talk about risk assessment, what is the risk assessment? So the risk assessment is a systemic process to evaluate the possibility of the risk that these elements can be introduced in a drug product. And it can exceed the PDE levels which are prescribed. So typically these are established during the R&D stages of drug product development. So the typical risk assessment level process involves three major steps. The step one is to identify known and potential source of elemental impurities that may find their way into the drug product. So this is usually done by a system called fishbone analysis system. So where we say, okay, our target is elemental impurities in drug product. What all can contribute to the elemental impurities? So to manufacture any drug product, we need drug substance. So drug substance can contribute if it has anything. So excipient can contribute. So then we pack the drug product, either tablet or capsule or injectable, in a container closure system. So that container closure system can contribute any impurities which can leach from there. Also the manufacturing equipment and water. So these drug substance and excipients can be controlled when we take a care to, or when we identify, okay, this raw material I want to use in the drug product. So we can take a care and we can control them by doing a qualification, and then we can do it. Because there are many common excipients like calcium carbonate or calcium-based excipients. They contain lead, arsenic, and those kind of heavy metals, because these calcium-based excipients are mostly mined from the natural sources. For example, calcium carbonate, it is mostly mined from the natural resources. Same with the manufacturing equipment, potentially can contribute a lot of impurities because they are made up of stainless steel equipment. So even though when we use 316 stainless steel, they can cause problems. For example, if we heat a citric acid solution in a stainless steel reactor, that can create that can leach nickel or vanadium from the equipment. So these are typical risk scenarios. So when we do the process development, we have to evaluate and we have to consider these risks. Similarly, water can contribute to the elemental impurities. So we need to have a proper GMP control and monitoring process of water so that we can eliminate or minimize this risk. In the step two, we have to evaluate the presence of a particular elemental impurity in the drug product, either by determining the observed or predicted levels and comparing it with the PDE, the permitted daily exposure limits. And in the step three, we have to identify if controls are built into the process, is there sufficient to or identify additional controls and to be considered for the limit of elemental impurities. So in summary, we have to create a summarized document and document this risk assessment because this is going to be part of our approval process. So for example, we have a oral drug product, which is made by a direct compression, which has n number of excipients. We have a drug substance, and then we have a MCC, we have lactose, we have calcium phosphate, we have a disintegrant cross-povidone, we have a lubricant, a magnesium stearate. We might use coating materials like hydroxypropyl methyl cellulose, titanium dioxide, coloring agents, iron oxide. So all these can become one drug product. So assume just a random example this is. So we have this one has this much daily intake. So in total, we have say, for example, we take one tablet a day. So each tablet contains this one. So that this drug product is about 2.5 gram. So intentionally, what are all we added in this? So individually, we have to go to each component of the drug formulation and we have to list that. So these are like, say, for example, in the drug substance, we use palladium and nickel as a catalyst. So then we have to put that as a risk. Then similarly for the potential elemental impurities which can come. So in this case, all the first category, the class one, becomes a common for all the individual components. And then what are the potential elemental impurities that can come from the manufacturing equipment? So this we have to individually review each of every component's process schemes from the respective manufacturers or respective manufacturer recommendation. So that we have to list here. And then potential elemental impurities that can come from the container closure systems. Being a oral tablet, it is a solid dosage form. So it doesn't have any direct interaction with any container closure system. So that risk becomes minimum. So in a solid state, it is not going to take any elemental impurity from the HDP bottle or a strip or in a blister. So that becomes none. So when we combine all this together, so the elements to be risk assessed are, so we have arsenic, we have cadmium, we have mercury, we have lead. So these four comes from the common for class one. And then we have nickel, we have vanadium, and then cobalt, which is missing from the class 2A, which is also being added here, and then palladium. So these eight impurities now becomes a risk assessment for this particular product. So like this, every product, we need to do an exercise during the product development, and then we have to establish a criteria to assess this impurity, which are the impurities to be analyzed or to be risk assessed. So now we know these impurities to be monitored in this drug product. So now, how do we design or develop controls? So typically the controls we have established using the quality by design approach. So the quality by design approach is rather than building the quality during the manufacturing, we are in the design itself, during the development itself, we are building the quality. So all components like API and excipients are analyzed at batch levels based on their risk assessment process as recommended by their respective manufacturers, because not every time we will be the manufacturer of excipient or API. So these limits are derived tighter than the permitted daily exposure levels so that varying quantities in drug product, different drug product can be handled. Similarly, all the processing equipments are designed or modified based on the worst case scenario approaches. For example, we can use glass lined reactors for heating operations involving acidic solutions. So that way we don't get any leaching from the process equipments. Similarly, we can incorporate in-process monitoring steps when a risk is identified. Say, for example, we have to do a heating process in a stainless steel reactor. Okay, then that particular process, we give a more control and we add a process monitoring step whereby we minimize that risk. Also, evaluating the container closures for leaching studies and employing alternative packaging components when potential risk is found. Say, for example, we have a drug product which interacts with the rubber septum, then we can use the neoprene septum. So like that, we can do the different changes and we can see how we can minimize. Also, we can try use of alternative process or design of alternative dosage forms whenever it is possible. For example, in case of injectable solution, switching from glass bottle with rubber stopper to foam-filled sealed bottles like LDP bottles, where it forms from the pellets, it forms the bottle during the filling and then it seals. Also, we can that way we can avoid the leaching from the stoppers. Similarly, what we can do is we can switching from the injectable liquid to powder for injections. So that way it becomes a solid, so the exposure to the rubber surface becomes minimized at the liquid stage so that the leaching goes down. So now, after we design and develop the controls, now we have to establish the quality control analytical methods. So To do the quality control analytical methods, we have three options here. We don't need to analyze each and every batch. So we have three options. So one is a drug product analysis option, and another one is summation option, and the third one is individual component option. So this option is basically from the USP as well as from the European Pharmacopoeia. So this, the first option, drug product analysis option, is like any other product, we analyze every batch and then we see how much we got the impurity, we measured impurity, and then we multiply that with the daily dose and then we end up to compare that with the limit prescribed by the pharmacopoeial guideline or the ICH guideline. So for an example, this drug product we analyzed. So we got this much microgram per gram for each of these impurities. And then we are calculating based on the maximum daily dose, assuming that is one tablet a day, so the 2.5 gram per day. So the calculated PDE is this amount, so whereas the limit is this amount, so then it becomes pass. So this is typical quality control analysis whereby we do individual drug product every batch, we analyze and see based on the result and we pass the batch. Whereas there is another option, which is summation option. So in this option, what we can do is we can take the individual amounts of the elemental impurity present in the each component of the drug product. And then the results of this individual impurity, we can sum it up. So that we can compare it with the daily dose, and which should not be not more than the daily permitted daily dose for the PDE. But using this option, before using this, we have to have a very well documented evidence and validation procedures to establish that our process or the packaging system doesn't add any additional elemental impurities that can be part of the drug product, because we individually analyze. Now we are not analyzing the drug product. We are individually analyzing the components in the drug product and then we are adding it together. So this is another alternative option. So usually what will happen is people in the industry during the validation of the process and the manufacturing, they do the first step drug product analysis option. and that compared with the individual component results, and then they end up in saying that, okay, after this, we are going to do the summation option. So to verify that, we will be doing every year one batch or five batches, or depending on that. So that can be varied depending on the process of this one. So then there is a third option, which is called individual component option. So this is applicable only to drug products which are less than 10 gram dose per day. So here in this case, if all the drug substance and the excipients in a formulation meet the concentration limits, which is less than the prescribed limit, approximately like 1 by 10th of the PDE dose, a detailed limit, a table with what level for each metal is available in the USP and even in the ICH, so we can you can refer that. So this option only, we have to remember, that can be applied only when the dose is not more than 10 gram. So now we know what is the limit we have to do, and we know what are the controls we have to do. So now we need analytical procedure, how to do the analysis for these ones, because we are talking about in microgram per gram. So we cannot do any titration or normal common analytical techniques. So now we have to see what are the recommended analytical validation parameters or analytical methods by the guidelines or the pharmacopoeias. In ICH guideline, they doesn't specifically give any analytical technique or procedure, but in individual pharmacopoeias, USP, European pharmacopoeia, Japanese pharmacopoeia, they all recommend a technique called inductively coupled optical emission spectrophotometer. In short form, it's called as ICP-OES, and ICP-MS is the same technique with the different detection using a mass spectrophotometer. So these two are the common techniques which are employed in the industry. So when utilizing these pharmacopoeial methods using ICP-OES or ICP-MS, we need a very minimum validation specific to the drug product is sufficient. So typically they do specificity, accuracy, and robustness, and that is enough to complete, because the process and the procedure is already established. So it is also, we can do the alternative analytical methods. So all the pharmacopoeias, like they allow the alternative methods with validation. The typical validation parameters are a little bit different than the normal ICH validation process. So when we do alternative tests, say for example, I develop a different method, a limit test based method. So it is a non-instrumental method, but in a different way, like whatever the existing limit test problems, I eliminate. And if I create a new limit test, yes, that can be done. The validation you have to do for the specificity and for the limit of detection. And the limit of detection should be minimum of 80% of the limit. Say for example, you have 5 ppm, 5 microgram per day, you have the limit. So that should minimum detect at least 4 microgram per day. You can also develop a limit test based on the instrumental method. So those methods, we have to prove that it is specific, it is precise, and the limit of detection. Again, the limit of detection, same 80% limit applies here also. So when we do alternative quantitative method similar to ICP-OES or ICP-MS to replace that, then we need to validate the accuracy. So the accuracy should be proven to that the new method which we developed is having at least 70 to 150% of the recovery in three different levels, from 50 to 150% of the target. So for each level, we need to have duplicate samples established, and each level should be within 70 to 150 for each sample. So basically you will have 9 samples. For 50%, you will have 3 samples. For 100%, you will have 3 samples. And 150%, you will have 3 samples. So it will be 9 samples. All these 9 samples should be within 70 to 150% of recovery. And then precision we need to prove for the quantitative method. So that should be in 2 levels you have to prove. So one, you have to prove in repeatability, it should be not more than 20% difference. And also we have to prove an intermediate precision either by the same analyst in different days or different analysts in different days or different labs in different days. So these intermediate precision should be not more than. And then obviously we had to prove the specificity for each of these metals. And then the linearity should and the range of this method should be at least 50 to 150% of the target. And the most important thing in this is the limit of quantification. So the minimum, it should be 50% of the limit should be detected. So say for example, 5 microgram per day, it should be 2.5 microgram per day should be minimum quantifiable. So that's the key requirement for the analytical method validation for the alternative methods. So now the recommended sample preparation, so that is the very key in the elemental impurity analysis. So you don't have any problem for liquids like say for example mineral oil or polyethylene glycol 400 which are already in the liquid. So you can directly use the neat sample as such, the liquid sample for the analysis. Similarly, if any solid is completely soluble in aqueous solvent like water or pH 1.2 buffer or pH 7.8 buffer or any buffer for that matter. So that can be also used directly. Also similarly, if any compound is completely soluble in organic solvent, you can just dissolve and you can use it. So the indirect solution, so when a material is not soluble in any of the aqueous or organic solvents, so that then the total metal extraction should be performed. So the preferred sample preparation for this one is digestion method using a closed vessel digestion procedure. So they basically what they do is they take the drug substance or the excipient, say for example, MCC, we cannot dissolve 100% MCC in any of the cellulose-based materials in water or in organic solvent. Similarly, many polymers. So these samples, we had to take them and we had to digest in concentrated acids or other forms depending on the sample matrix. So most of the they use the closed vessel digestion. So the important is here is the closed vessel digestion should minimize the loss of volatile elemental impurities, because what happens is when you heat the sample, mercury like elementals they can evaporate, they can become volatile and they can go off. So that's the one which we have to take care when we do. The most commonly used technique is a closed vessel microwave digestion. Basically, it is same like our microwave oven, which we use it at home, but with the different modifications of the vessel. The reaction vessels will be there, so which we can put our samples and the acid and we can close it and set the time with the different agitation rates and all those things we can do. And then, so that can be used as indirect solution. So in this, we are trying to extract all the metal from the sample using acids. So usually all these elements are soluble in the concentrated acids or stronger acids. So that's the basic principle in this closed vessel digestion. So when we look at the different analytical equipment techniques, the ICP-OES, which is so basically what happens in the ICP-OES is we have the sample. The sample is pumped through a pump to a spray chamber. So in the spray chamber, the pressure is created using argon gas, which is an inert gas, which doesn't react with any of the metal impurities. So that sprayed sample solution flows through a torch. So this torch is basically the plasma, this one. So it creates a flame from the metal sample. So this flame emits a light. So how it emits a light is, so when a metal is in the ground state, it takes the energy from the plasma and it moves into the excited state. So when it moves into the excited state, it creates a fluorescent spectrum. So that fluorescent spectrum is specific to each metal. So this advantage of this method is it is very sensitive. It is, we can up to measure nanogram per ml concentrations. And the other advantage is we can simultaneously analyze multiple elements like HPLC, how we do, like 2-3 compounds we can analyze in a single run. Same way we can analyze all these 24 elements in a single run. So that is the biggest advantage. Of course, the disadvantages are there. The problem is, since we use the plasma and the argon gas, we need the controlled environment. Basically, we need like a clean room for this equipment to be placed. And cost of the equipment as well as cost of analysis per sample, both are very high in those cases. And other problem or disadvantages, this is pretty much common in any of the elemental analysis because, as I said, it gets into the excited state and it emits the fluorescent spectrum. These fluorescent spectrum are subject to matrix effects based on the coexisting elements. Say, for example, I take calcium carbonate and I do the elemental analysis for the arsenic, the lead, and this one. Calcium is going to be very, very high concentration in that sample because whatever the technique I use, calcium are also going to dissolve along with the elementals. Other elements like arsenic or lead or cadmium or mercury for that matter. So this concentration of calcium going to create a trouble because calcium also going to get excited and it is also going to emit its fluorescent spectrum, which is going to be very strong because it's high in concentration. So this matrix interference is going to be there in all the cases, not only in this analytical technique, pretty much in every analytical technique which we use for the elemental analysis. Similarly, the inductively coupled mass spectrophotometer or ICP-MS. So it is similar to the ICP-OES, only the detection part is different. So similar to that, the sample is pumped through a nebulizer where you have a spray chamber, which pressured by the argon gas. And that from that spray chamber, the sample is moved into a fine particles, and then the plasma excites that. So the excited elements are now detected by mass spectrophotometer instead of fluorescent signal. So the advantage is here we have sensitivity higher than the OES. So this goes up to picogram per ml levels. Here also we can analyze simultaneously. And similar to ICP-OES, here also we need a controlled environment because we use the argon gas, which cannot be publicly or commonly exhausted. So it has to be separately exhausted through a separate exhaust system. And similarly, the cost of the equipment and the cost to perform each analysis is higher. Even though here we don't go in the route of fluorescence, the mass we do it here also considerable matrix interference from the higher concentration elements are there because from the nebulizer we had to send the elements and then through the quadrupole technique we used to use the quadrupole technique to differentiate the elements. So when one element is in the higher concentration, it becomes very difficult to isolate the lower concentration elements. So matrix impact will be there here also. but relatively a little bit easy to troubleshoot and develop the method here compared to the OES. Otherwise, pretty much the basic principle is commonly common for both these equipments. So there is a other technique which commonly people use, which is X-ray fluorescence spectrophotometer. So basically what happens here is to make the element to excite and emit the fluorescence, we use an X-ray tube here. So the X-ray beam is beamed onto the sample, and then it is detected by a detector. Then the X-ray hits to the element's outer shells, the element get excited, because instead of plasma energy, it uses the X-ray energy to get excited. So this creates a fluorescence by each element, which is again specific to each element. And then those are detected by the special detectors. So these detectors and process this through their computerized software with the algorithms, they differentiate each of these method. The biggest advantage with this method is if some sample is not soluble, we don't need to go through the closed vessel digestion process, whereby we have to use very concentrated acid and all those things. Here we can just directly keep the solid sample and we can get it, because X-ray can penetrate through solid surface. So that's the one biggest advantage of this method. And the second thing is here also simultaneously we can do the analysis for all the elements. And also the cost of analysis is very cheap here compared to the ICP-OES or ICP-MS. Also, the instrument operation is much simpler compared to ICP-OES or ICP-MS. Pretty much it's like operating like a UV. It's that much simple. The disadvantage is the sensitivity. The sensitivity, it is only up to microgram levels. It is not into the nanogram or picogram levels. And the matrix interferences here also, it is high. Little bit expertise is needed to, our experience is needed to develop these methods. So these three are the very common analytical techniques which people use in the industry for the elemental analysis. Apart from this, yes, other analytical techniques also we can use. The other popular techniques are like atomic absorption spectrophotometer. Yes, theoretically you can use the atomic absorption spectrophotometer. The challenges are sensitivity. And then atomic absorption is every element we have to do one by one. So that means multiple methods. So multiple methods means multiple amount of sample. So it is not quite easy to, on a routine basis, to get more samples to do some analysis, because some samples are, say for example, my dose is only 10 microgram per day. Then if I ask my production people or my quality assurance to give me 100 gram for analysis, then they're going to tell me, okay, with 100 gram, we will make 10 batches. Why do we need to give you for testing? So that's the common problem happens with these kind of methods. We can also do by ion chromatography and HPLC. The challenge is again here also the sensitivity, because ion chromatography or the electrochemical detection or the other derivatization methods, when we do, the sensitivity is not up to the level of what we get it in the ICP-MS or the ICP-OES levels, but it can be equal to X-ray fluorescence levels. But the counter effect is the sample quantity as well as the method optimization. And then since it is a HPLC, we have to dissolve the sample and extract the metal. So all those hurdles are going to be there. It can be done, but it has to be, these challenges has to be overcome on this. A pretty new technique is this, they have developed a DNA specific ligands which are specific to each metal. So these DNAs, so these are pretty interesting technique, but the challenge is it is relatively emerging new technique, so not many choices available commercially. And also the cost is, right now it is very high, but probably it may go down over the period when the application is being explored and expanded in the access. So these are the different analytical methods we can go with this one. I think that's all I have. Hopefully I didn't bore you all. Questions or any discussions?
Thank you, sir, for your excellent presentation with crystal clear explanation. So now I'll take up the questions from the chat box and present before you.
Sure.
So the first question from participants, is there any pre-treatment of sample needed for ICP-MS, that is inductively coupled plasma mass spectrophotometer?
Yes, it is depending on the sample. We need certain pre-treatments. Most of the samples whereby you, if you dissolve it in completely in aqueous or organic solvents, you don't need any special pre-treatment. But what happens is when you do the indirect digestion, it becomes very important to do some pre-treatment. For example, you have high salt content in your sample. Say, for example, you have sodium chloride, high sodium chloride. So what happens is sodium chloride will precipitate during the nebulization process, when the during the plasma nebulization. So those kind of things has to be pre-treated when it comes to the ICP-MS or ICP-OES.
So I'll take up the next question, sir. Is this limits and guidelines applicable to all products, including over the counter products, or only to new prescription drug products?
Based on the pharmacopoeia procedure, if we take, USP is common for any drug product manufactured in US market. So whether it is over-the-counter product or whether it is a prescription drug product, this limits has to be followed when a product is claimed as a USP or EP or a Japanese pharmacopoeia.
Is there any method to purify organic compounds other than column chromatography?
Yes, you can use partial crystallization process, solvent-based precipitation processes, but they're not going to be that much easy. It depends on the different category of the impurities which you have it in your sample. So if you have close impurities, the partial crystallization cannot be easily resolved. So when it is very close related impurities, column chromatography is the best solution. The higher the purity you need, better the method you can apply.
Okay, sir. Can we use any validated analytical method, or it should be any specific method?
Any validated analytical method can be used. Any say, for example, we don't have ICP-OES, but we can develop a method using HPLC. Yes, you can validate that as long as you meet the validation criteria which is set in the USP or in the respective pharmacopoeia, you can use that method. It is not necessary that you have to only use ICP-OES or this one, because I might be having a product which is very low dose, maybe 0.1 microgram per 10 microgram only per day, say for example, like thyroxin products, which is very low dose. So those ones are not needed high sensitivity levels. So So we can either do it by X-ray fluorescence or HPLC or even UV-based derivatization methods you can develop and you can use it. As long as you validate any method, you can use that.
The next question, sir, it is required to analyze each and every batch of raw material and drug product.
Yes, this is a little bit clear explanation is needed because what happens is this is a whole quality system process. So you can, with the three options, you can like say, for example, the drug product analysis option, you did your risk assessment and you say that, okay, now my risk assessments are minimum. I know only these are the sources of my elemental impurities can come from. So those one you validated and have in process control, then you don't need to analyze every batch. So periodically you can do certain batches and then you don't need to do the every batch analysis. So that is called skip testing or bracketing and matrixing method during the batch release. So that can be employed. So you don't need to analyze every batch.
Okay, sir. Should we need to monitor these impurities in stability monitoring, sir?
For solid products, you don't need to because for like a tablet or capsule, it is very low possibility that element can migrate from a HDPE bottle or a blister pack or a alu pouch to solid product. But if it is a liquid injections, like say, for example, you have injectable drug products with liquids. So those ones you have to monitor in the stability because during the storage, it can start leaching slowly from the rubber septums or from the HDPE bottles. So liquid products, yes, you have to definitely monitor. But solid products, you don't need to monitor.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. With your permission, as in our HDTP, many of them are student participants. I'd like to ask you from academic point of view, what would you recommend for a student to get better knowledge or understanding on this subject so that he can be better prepared for industry environment? As you're having more than 20 years of experience, I have always used this question for you, sir.
Oh, sure, definitely. The best starting point is the ICH Q3D guidelines. So it is it's around 60 to 70 guideline, but it gives a very detailed explanation for each of the case scenarios. It even gives the examples like the table which I put is some of them are practically adapted from the guideline. So if you go over the guideline, probably as a in a classroom, as a group discussion, we can discuss those in a typical environment that will give them much better understanding because in a group discussion, what I don't know, somebody might explain me better. That will be a good option to start. And then they can read through the general chapters in the USP, European Pharmacopoeia, Japanese Pharmacopoeia. If anybody needs that, please feel free to mail me. I can share it.
Okay, sir. With your vast experience and being a CEO, I hope you might be the right person for saying this. Any specific suggestions for students for doing project on these areas?
Oh, sure. There are a lot of opportunities. See, the common methods which the industry follows is ICP-OES, ICP-MS, and the X-ray fluorescence. But the other techniques like HPLC and these ones, they can be developed. Say, for example, you don't need 24 elements to be coming in a single run. You can make only a method for only the four elemental impurities, like the class one impurities. So for arsenic, lead, like that. So there are many published papers are already there, shown certain level. Okay, this much level we can go, this much sensitivity we can go. So there are many ways we can increase those sensitivities because some papers are like from the 1970s and 1980s and not much people work on further enhancing those techniques. So those type of things definitely can very well. I am from project. Definitely, people, student can learn from those type of exploratory works. So that would be much useful to the student himself as well as for many small industries. They can adopt those kind of published papers and they can develop from those methods.
Okay, sir, the last question. Can you please suggest any analytical technique to detect both elemental as well as regular impurities in a single sample?
It can be done. Organic and inorganic impurities can be done in a single method, but it is not going to be sensitive enough. If, say, for example, if I need to analyze the most common product, famotidine is there, which is an organic product, which is commonly available in a fixed dose combination with aluminum hydroxide, calcium carbonate, like that, antacids. So those kind of higher level ones, we can definitely do it in a single run. Even I do have a paper like which I did like that probably 2009 or 2010, which is in a single run, we did organic and inorganic compounds. So those can be done, but if we are looking for like one at 5 microgram and another at 10 microgram or a higher level, it is difficult. Because what will happen is you need a common detection technique. So when you talk about a common detection technique for both, either you need to derivatize the inorganic compound or you need to go to a mass-based detection. So when you go to a mass-based detection also, what will happen is the inorganic impurities mass will be very low because the elemental impurities atomic masses are very less, whereas your organic impurity masses are going to be high. So the mass filtration on the detection level in a single run is going to be very difficult in a LC-MS level. But if you go to LC-MS-MS level, you can do it. But when you go to LC-MS-MS level, your goal or your target defeats. Because in a LC-MS-MS, I don't need to do all this. I can simply go back in a different way. So simple HPLC with the UV detection or simple HPLC with the fluorescence detection, it will be too difficult. It is not, I won't say it is not achievable, it can be achievable, but if the concentrations are higher, if you are doing for an active pharmaceutical ingredient, it can be easy. But if you are doing in a drug product, it's going to be a little bit complex because you're going to have other products, so you need to extract. So that is going to be a little bit complex.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir, for your valuable explanation and crystal clear explanation. I hope the participants have cleared their queries with your answers. So yes. Now I request our principal, sir, to give a few words to the participants.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you, Sushma.
Thank you, sir.
Good morning, Ravi sir, Bhaskar Agaru, and other participants from Western countries. And very wonderful evening to the participants who occupied this virtual classroom. On behalf of the management, faculty, and students of Bhagatla College of Pharmacy, I wish to extend my sincere thanks to the three resource persons for their vast, elaborative discussion, deliberations with respect to various novel trends of analytical techniques. The day one started with bioanalytical methods. The principles, fundamentals, concepts, validation requirements of bioanalytical methods was discussed by the day one person. And the day two is related to the fundamentals, applications of mass spectroscopy in various analytical point of view and prospects and applications. And today, day three, about elemental impurities. From first year B form onwards, this inorganic impurities were not discussed in academic point of view. The inorganic elements will be discussed in different angle, like what are the applications of inorganic ions, inorganic salts, and what are the qualitative and quantitative approaches for estimation of various anions as well as cations, and where the quantity will be abundant and it can be estimated by volumetric methods also. But in case of impurity, where they are present in very minute amounts, the here LODs, LOQs are very crucial, and the routine analytical methods which we use it to count in our regular academic profiles is not sufficient. And today's speaker definitely touched in a different aspect that will be that is going to be good beneficial for the participants with respect to estimation of impurities, even they are present in very minute amounts. And impurities, especially the inorganic or organic impurities, are likely to improve, likely to alter the stability aspects, and there will be extraction from the packing materials. They may enter into the water. In this way, they are having various role, and that is highlighted by today's speaker. So I am extremely happy with these three deliberations. And once again, I am very much thankful to all three resource persons for their dedication, commitment towards the profession. And I wish to extend my sincere thanks to the co-partner of this session is IPA Education Division Chairman and one of my good friends, Dr. S. Vijayadara, who extend his consent for support with IPA Education Division. And I am also extremely happy with the work contributed by analytical department faculty, Ranjit and Sushma in particular. And I cannot ignore the services rendered by technical support, John, throughout. This is the fifth international webinar conducted from our organization. In all five webinars, the wonderful contribution is provided by John Sagar. So we are very much happy with the performance and services contributed by John. And the success of any program is undoubtedly is due to the credit of participants, because though we are having different sources, until unless participants are not there, that program cannot become a success. So I wish to extend my sincere thanks to the participants who joined this webinar, this STTP short-term training program, which includes various faculty members, representatives from various industries, and the student community. Definitely, your participation is going to encourage our organizing team so that we can conduct such kind of events in future. And once again, I am very much thankful to all the persons who directly or indirectly involved for the success of this three-day STTP, and wish you good day, Ravi sir, and wish you a good night for all the participants. Thank you one and all. And I'm now hand over to Sushma. Please proceed.
Thank you, sir. So, and that is to the participants. Actually, now the feedback link will be placed, and once you fill this feedback form only, you are eligible for getting your e-certificate. And the feedback form will be active for an hour. So please kindly cooperate and fill the feedback form in time, then mailing me that you have not filled your feedback form. So please kindly fill your feedback form in time. The feedback form will be active for an hour. And that is within 2 days, you'll be getting a mail. And if you fill your details over there, you'll be getting your e-certificate. And this e-certificate will be issued only for the participants based on their feedback form and your attendance, that is your attendance towards the session. Thank you, participants, for making this program successful. Thank you, one and all. Ravi sir, thank you for your support. It was really an excellent performance.
Thank you, Sushma. Thanks, Ranjit.